Hi everybody, it's me, it's Dr. Kestler, Lorain County Community College, and welcome to today's COVIDio. There's a lot going on in the area of COVID-19, and I want to tell you we are in the middle of an upturn. I just want to tell you I've been watching it for a few days, but I'm not going to talk about that. I am going to today talk about the future and where we are and where we will be. And some of this is projections and predictions, but I want to focus on one thing. I teach a lot of people in healthcare, and my healthcare people have been with me all the way on this and listening all the way, and this one's for you. This one is about predicting the burden of COVID-19 on the healthcare system, and let's talk a little bit about it. So first of all, I'll tell you my temperature today is 96.5 degrees Fahrenheit, which is 35.8 centigrade. So that's where I am sitting. So my first little piece of evidence I want to talk about here is hospital resource use. And here is the very good story that I have to tell you about Ohio. I'm bragging a little bit here about Ohio. The news is not good all over the place, but in Ohio at least it is good, thanks to Governor DeWine and Dr. Acton. By doing what we did when we did, I think we did a tremendous job of doing this. This is what we were after right here. And this is basically real data up until the middle of this graph where it says today. That's all real. Beyond today is tomorrow, and that's all projection. So we're making a prediction. This is sort of like doing the weather. You know, when you see the hurricane predictions and it goes to this, and you know, they've gotten pretty good about that. So we're here. I'm the COVID weatherman today. I'm going to try to predict where things are going to be. And I have to tell you, we're looking at a couple things here. We're looking at, in this particular graphic, this is from the John Hopkins data. And you'll notice that there is a couple of lines that go straight across the horizon on this graph. One of them is all beds, hospital beds, and then there is ICU beds. You can see that we pushed the limit on our ICU beds, intensive care unit. Sorry, I should explain what that means. These are hospital beds, our intensive care units. And you can see we pushed it back in early May. We were pushing it. We were very close to capacity. And then we brought it around. We did not exceed that capacity, and we brought it around, and now we're sitting pretty good. And the projections out to October are actually pretty nice. I think we will be in great shape. We will be able to take care of all of our ill, and we're very well poised to do that. Now, barring, you know, I'm making a prediction, and there are things that can impact the future, and certainly human behavior can, depending on how we act and behave. And yeah, you saw that. I did do that. How we react, and I'll talk about masks later on. I want to look at Texas, and one of the things is Texas has been in the news a lot because they are also having an outbreak right now. And of course, up until now, everything has been okay. I don't have the lines on this one. For some reason, this one didn't show up the lines, but I'll get back into it later. But Texas has done pretty well and is poised to continue that way. The Texas data are in the inset. You can see the beds that we predict out by September 30th. This is the future, and Texas should handle it. I know you see Florida on there, and so I'm not going to talk about Florida yet, but I want to tell you about Florida in just a bit. So Texas, Arizona, Florida are where there is some huge things going on. Let me go to Arizona is the other big one. And here you can see in this one I have, just like the Ohio data, I have shown all beds available, and then ICU beds, and then this is where we are. So it shows you the all beds available. That shadow there is how they're getting ready to build capacity to make it so that they can have enough. The ICU beds available right now is that nice flat line down in the there's about what is it, 500. There's about 500 ICU beds available, and you can see that even right about now, we are very close to pushing that. So the intensive care beds needed, we can see that we're going to need about 800. We'll be beyond capacity in Arizona. So Arizona is got to think about how they are going to serve the people. That is where there's going to be a great need coming going forward. But the real story is this story here. This is Florida, and Florida is, I think, going to be quite bad. I've been watching for a while. I've been worried about Florida for some time, and I think we are poised to have Florida look like worst case scenario, look like Italy. The next worst case scenario look like New York. But I think they better get ready for what I think is going to be some problems. So what you can see here on this particular graphic, you can see the ICU beds that are available, and they have 1,600. They're a larger population than Arizona, so they have about 1,600 beds ICU available. And then we've got the ICU beds needed. And by October 1st, the projections are that we're going to need twice as many. And a little bit extra than that, going out into October. We will also be needing lots of regular hospital beds, and it shows you where we are, and it shows you what will be the beds available are that nice flat line. The beds that will potentially be needed will definitely exceed that's that line there, and gets really close to the beds available. That is about where we are going forward. And it could be quite if the line goes more towards it could be worse, it could be better, but that's a real serious kind of issue. And I know I've been talking a lot about masks, and I can't stop talking about masks because masks are the answer. I'm telling you that masks, distance matters. And as we go forward, we have a lot of people who have troubles with this. I was just talking to a class of mine this morning, and I was reminding them that this word quarantine, historically, we have not had so much problem with the word quarantine as we do right now. And the reason I think is because of young people. When we had measles outbreaks, we were quarantining homes and people thought that was just dandy. And when we had polio, people self-quarantined. That was all, and people thought that was very acceptable. The fact is that affected young people. And I think the fact that it doesn't affect young people, that it affects older people, that maybe that is the problem there. Let me tell you what masks can do. First of all, you've seen all of the data. I showed you last week the data where I cough, and I can feel the pressure of that on my hand when I cough like that. I wanted to do a different experiment, and we did this last week in the lab, and we did an experiment that I call close talker. And I did this experiment. Let me just mimic it for you before I show you the data. And the experiment is this. I take a petri dish, and I actually we put it 20 centimeters away from my face. So we measured it. We got a ruler out and we measured it. And then 20 centimeters out, I said the following things with no mask on. I said, "The rain in Spain falls mainly on the plain." That level of voice, not this level, this is a little louder. That level of voice, "The rain in Spain falls mainly on the plain." I put that petri dish down, and you can see on the slide here. Let me go back to the slide, and that's what it looks like with no mask. Now, I put my nylon mask. I think you've all seen that bluish nylon mask that I have. That was the worst performing mask that I tested, the worst. And all I did was put that over my face, and I
held a petri dish right here, and I said the rain in Spain falls mainly on the plain.
And when I did that, you see this, the petri dish right next to it, and that petri dish is clear. So even a mask that is not very good can be very helpful when you're talking. Now, one more experiment I want to show you, and that is your behavior affects me. My behavior affects you. This is community effort. This is where we work together and we help each other. And I took two masks here, and I took the worst masks I had to show this, and I did the this is a cough experiment. So I cough 1, 2, 3 times. And so how this works is I cough once without a mask. I cough second one. The one mask is a mask on me. And the third petri dish is when I put a mask over the petri dish that I'm coughing to, same distance. So I'm two masks on me and on the petri dish. And that's what you see there. So you can see, no masks. I got a good number of bacteria out. And by the way, these are bacteria. Bacteria are bigger than virus sometimes even as much as tenfold bigger than virus. So bacteria can go through easier or harder. It's harder to get them through. They block more, viruses much more. But you can clearly see the effect of two masks. So my masks helps you, but your mask also helps you. And if we both wear masks, we are in great shape. Of course, you don't have to wear a mask in your car. You don't have to wear a mask when you're home alone or you're working in your workspace alone. And so this is a very kind of simple thing that we can do, and I think it's definitely not that terrible. And it is a good way to be a helper. It is a good way to be good to each other. And may you all persist like a lentivirus. Thank you and have a good day.